So with that, we will get started. The topic for the day, commercial launch enablement for emerging life sciences companies. Good afternoon or morning or evening, depending on where you are in the world. My name is Denny Gracie. I'm Vice President of Healthcare and Life Sciences in the US for Customertimes, and I'll be moderating our webinar today. Those of you planning for launch have much on your plates, and we really appreciate you taking time out of your busy day to spend with us this afternoon or morning or evening. This webinar is about launch enablement. Your business strategy has likely been developed, and you now need to create a timeline, budget, and roadmap to enable the full suite of business capabilities required. Your first step is to inventory that full set of capabilities, which we will be presenting on today. Then you need to go about selecting partners with software, services, data, and technologies delivered in an integrated, cohesive enablement plan. We're assuming that you're likely here today because this could be your first time supporting a product launch ever, or you've launched before, but with existing software. Some of you have come from a large pharma where you already had all the systems in place. You just needed to set up your launch for your particular product. But you're going to need solutions and services in place, and you now need to build them from scratch. Or third, you'd like to hear about any new hot topics for commercial enablement that we're going to discuss. Or four, you want to learn about alternatives to the legacy brands and vendors providing launch enablement over the past decade or so. Based on these assumptions about why you might be here today, we offer a few key objectives for our webinar. First, if you haven't started already, we'd like to kickstart your launch plans. Also, present some of the key considerations for commercial enablement planning and roadmap. Discuss the hot topic of true 360 customer view and engagement. And introduce you to some subject matter experts, trusted solutions and service providers to support your commercial launch. Okay, we've organized this webinar with a few trusted partners. All of us are providing complementary solutions and services to support commercial launch. All of us are also directly or tangentially related to Salesforce as the core platform of enablement. As you can see, we have a packed agenda, but we're going to move quickly through the topics with different speakers. And I'm sure as you glance down the list, you'll find topics of interest and relevance for you. In addition to the four key speakers, we have an extended set of partners who are in the audience, and before we open for Q&A, I'll quickly introduce these partners with a summary of their respective solutions and services. With that, I'd like to introduce you to James Corbett, with over 25 years experience in commercial operations, advisory consulting, and president of Afore LLC, to present on key considerations for launch enablement and planning. James?
Hey, Danny, can you hear me?
Sure can.
Excellent. Hello, everybody. So I'm here to talk to you about what a commercial roadmap means by all the processes related to that. So let's define things for a second. So when I'm talking about a commercial roadmap, I'm talking about support for the five groups that are up on the screen currently. So marketing, sales, payer or market access, whichever terminology you prefer. Medical affairs, referring to your MSLs and your people out in the field, and then your compliance team, which typically isn't part of your commercial team, but in reality, in today's world, compliance is a part of every decision you make. Let's go next. There are other business systems that may tangentially apply. The majority of these will be in place prior to your commercial roadmap. So as you're making those decisions, they should have some impact on your commercial processes, but for the most part, they're complementary more so than anything else. For example, your Office 365 suite will work with your commercial systems, but it's not something that, in this example, I would define as a commercial system. We're going to kind of keep out of scope. All right, let's go next. Really, the systems we're talking about are the seven that just appeared. So we're going to refer to your CRM system. So that's typically where anyone in your field force, whether it be your sales teams, your MSLs, or your payer teams are working out in the fields and their activities that they're doing. Content, whether it be promotional content, quality content, anything that is used in today's digital space, especially with the fact that everyone is working virtually to share information out to the field, will have a major impact on the systems that are including that content. spend. Again, very compliance focused, but obviously all of the spend capture that you need to do out in the field to accurately report, we'll talk more about it, but data identifiers and master data management really feed into that, which gets us into the next group. So MDM, as far as master data management and what that means, reporting, then all the data that you're going to have, you want the reporting to appear. Contracting, really a number of contracting areas, one for your payer contracting, as well as all your internal contracting for HCP engagement, et cetera. And then the hubs. So you'll have a patient portal, an HCP portal. This is for enrollments for most products today that are coming out, especially in the biopharmaceutical space. Any field portals you may have, and benefit analysis in the more high-priced market products, really important, and that's integrated into your commercial roadmap. So at a very high level, this is the seven areas that will be part of your commercial roadmap. And underneath that, if you can go to the next, there are many, many pieces that make up all of that and where they slot in. So it's obviously an eye chart. We're going to break this out piece by piece and kind of walk you through for the next couple of minutes. So why don't we go to the next one? So let's focus in on the CRM space. So when it comes to your marketing team, all the multi-channel engagement really will be impacted in your CRM space. So the messaging that you want, the approved messaging, whether it be items such as closed loop marketing or emails that you send with your physicians, again, in the virtual space, this has become even more important. But in your marketing area, they want to know how their content is going to be shared via the CRM system and how that works. Salesforce makes that very easy, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. For your sales team, obviously your CRM system is a really core area. So whether it be all of the account planning that they do, all of the operational stuff, such as territory planning, the maintenance, and then simplistically, just the overall activity recording, the calls, the interactions. Again, in this day and age, everyone is doing this virtually. Once we get back out in the world and begin having face-to-face meetings, but a CRM system, really the core areas, for the most part, are focused on sales. That's not to say that your payer and your medical affairs team must be ignored. They use your CRM system just as much, and they have different needs. So you need a flexible CRM system that will support your payer team for when they're going and meeting with the Aetnas and Cignas of the world, or even state Medicaid, Medicare boards. They have to do all their key account management tracking. They need to track formulary information, positioning, et cetera. And your medical affairs system, again, very similar in CRM, yet different in the same respect. The MSLs, they really want to track their activities, and they really track their KOLs and how those are seen in the marketplace. One system has to support all of those key functions. Let's go next. So the content that goes into the CRM system is vitally important. Your marketing team wants to make sure all the promotional content matches the marketing messages. The sales team wants to use those messages in the CRM system, again, referring to closed loop marketing, any presentations they can share, any way they can redirect their HCPs to your websites, send them emails, et cetera. Your medical affairs content is going to be slightly different. They're going to want to work with anything that the medical fair messaging can have, any FAQs they may have, possibly some off-label discussions if they're approved. Their needs are slightly different, but need to be accounted for equally. And obviously, this is a place where compliance really cares. They want to make sure that all the policies are followed. They want to make sure that people are trained according to their roles and responsibilities. And they want to make sure that all the quality related to that is in the system as well. So content management is not just the deliverables, but the overall support for that content so that it meets all the SOPs and can withstand an audit. Let's go to the next. When people are out in the field, they're going to be spending money with all the regulations, both at the federal level, the state level, and globally. There are significant needs to ensure that you do accurate reporting. That starts with ensuring that you have identifiers and good data to submit that report. Brian will talk in a little bit about how MedPro can help you with that. You wanna make sure not just that you have the HCP and HCO list, you wanna make sure you have the license identifiers, the addresses, the affiliations. You wanna make sure that same list of information, HCPs and HCOs, are linked to your expense capture system. The majority of the industry uses Concur. And then, of course, all that data must be followed up and be shared into your open payment system. So this is where you report all your spend data and share it to, again, the federal, the state, or other countries or regions around the world. But accurately having your spend system as part of your infrastructure is critically important in today's age, day and age. So for spend to work properly, we'll go next to your master data management. Like I said, all the data related is really important, but MDM goes beyond spend as well. All the analysis that you're going to do for your marketing team, your targeting, your planning, will be based on your master data management data. No one does a launch based on one data set. There's always multiple data sets to consider, and that's where master data management comes in. Sales team is critically important. You want to make sure that you are creating your sales team based on the most current data. You want to make sure it's accurate. You don't want to send representatives on day one out to the wrong address or out to the wrong office. You want to make sure that you know which physicians are working in which organizations. Are they part of Kaiser? Are they part of UPMC, et cetera? And then of course you want to, once you're actually launched, you want to make sure all your data and your analysis works properly. So again, having that strong data foundation is critically important when you get to reporting. Speaking of payers, you want to do pricing and contracting. You want to understand which payers have the most impact on your product and your market. Having the accurate data, having that linkage and all that information is critically important, especially in today's day and age in the US. Medical affairs, the MSL reporting needs aren't as robust. However, of course, you want to ensure that the MSLs are having the greatest impact they can with their KOLs. So you want to link that data directly to your sales and your payer information. You can see where the MSLs are having the most impact without necessarily measuring it on a sales process. Let's go to the next one. So kind of hinting at reporting. Reporting obviously is going to be critical as you launch. You want to make sure that you have the ability to do all the analysis and transition. You want to execute on your sales plan, but at the same time, you want to have reports to measure and transition as you go forward. Marketing, obviously, they want to look at all the sales impact. They want to see how you're affecting the market. Sales team, they're going to care about their incentive compensation. Are they being paid appropriately? Are you incentivizing them in the correct way to actually launch your product? They're going to want to know, of course, how all their performance out in the field is working. They're going to want to know any sales data that's coming in, how is it impacting them or the market overall. Your payer team critically wants to know, again, which are the greatest accounts, whether it be the Aetna, the Cignas, who has the most impact? Where are we seeing the most impact with our pricing strategy? What do we need to adjust? How do we need to move forward? And your medical affairs team, again, transactionally, they want to know where they're having impact in the field. Let's talk about contracting, Denny. So contracting, we'll start under sales, HCP engagement, really keep it business term now. We want to make sure that as we contract with HCPs to talk in our speaker programs, to talk on the benefits of your new product and your company, you want to make sure that you're doing it in the most compliant way possible, tracking who's speaking for you, what's their compensation, are their contracts set up, et cetera. Managed care contract management is vitally important. Obviously, in today's day and age with pricing and contracting, you will have a pricing strategy. You will have a strategy on how you are going to present your product to the market itself. You want to measure that, ensure the contracting is set up in such a way that when it comes to rebates and positioning, everything is as you intended. And then compliance obviously wants to know everything around the contracts are meeting and are supporting the commercial strategy, as well as doing it in the most compliant way possible. And lastly, let's talk about the hubs. So hubs weren't that important 10, 15 years ago. I might be aging myself, maybe 20, 15 years ago, but they are completely critical to your commercial launch strategy. Salesforce is tremendously powerful in this area. So whether it be a patient hub or an HCP hub, you wanna know when people are enrolling with your product, or when physicians are enrolling patients for your product. All the content that you have that you're gonna share with your patients and your HCPs obviously have to be linked directly to your hub. Most sales teams have field portals so they can get access to content outside of the CRM. Salesforce is tremendous in that space. And then lastly, The payer team, as patients are signing up, you need to do a benefits analysis. That's going to require eligibility. What's the reimbursement? Is there going to be a copay? Is there not going to be a copay? That needs to be directly integrated into your portal or your patient services hubs. It's a critical component to ensure that patients can always get your product as quickly and easily and cost effectively as they can. So that was an awful lot to absorb. I went through, I'm not sure how many squares. There's overlap between all of them, but it's a setup to discuss how the commercial roadmap works. Denny, we'll go back to next. So awful lot to cover, lots of colors, lots of components that need to be considered. A roadmap is simply not a direct line. There are major overlaps. What system should go out when? Which groups are you supporting? What is your business process going to be? What is your launch strategy going to be? There's a lot of considerations to make. So with that overview, I'll turn it back over, Denny, and we can talk to the other partners.
Great. Before I go to the next topic, real quick, when should an organization get started with this? This is a lot of work to do. And what do you see?
Ideally, the strategy, the commercial roadmap strategy should be that conversation is starting 18 months before your planned launch date, PDUFA. And then each of the individual pieces will start according to your launch plan. Certain things take longer to launch than others. A hub takes longer to launch than a CRM system, a content management system, but there's dependencies there. But at 18 months, you should create your plan. If you're not executing 12 months before launch date for all of this, you're behind schedule. I would say overly simplifying it.
All right, very good. Well, thanks so much, James. With that, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Mickey Landgoff with Dot Compliance, which provide a full suite of quality management solutions on Salesforce. So while QMS is not typically considered a commercial function, many pre-commercial firms will use commercialization as an opportunity to upgrade their quality systems. And with that, I'll turn it over to Mickey.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Denny. Can you hear me well?
Can hear you well.
Okay, fantastic. So just quickly, thank you again. And I really want to thank Customertimes for inviting Dot Compliance to participate in this webinar about commercial launch. I think it's super important and a lot of great stuff has been covered. Dot Compliance, for those who do not know us, is a state-of-the-art quality management and compliance system powered by the force.com technology platform, obviously. And we support life science organizations with their commercialization activities when it comes to the management of quality, clinical, manufacturing, suppliers, and regulatory business processes and activities. I think as you saw in the previous section, James covered, these are all areas that serve in many cases as a foundation for commercial enablement and of course around content management, which there's plenty of. So on this particular slide, I just want to emphasize the fact that we've done the legwork for companies wanting to focus on getting their products to market quickly. And we fully created ready-to-use solutions that take a fraction of the time to set up these type of systems. So our Express package, which is on the screen here listed, includes all of the core quality management applications, including a full-blown document management, audit management, supplier quality management solutions, which are all essentially key pillars for successful product launch to any emerging company. Your company might have already made the move into this direction in the pre-commercial stage, but quality systems, you know, are essential, and it doesn't really matter whether you've done this or not, especially post-COVID. This is the time to either digitize any paper or Excel-based quality processes you may still have, or to further enhance an existing foundation with a more comprehensive and collaborative system. So on the next slide, Denny, I wanna talk a little bit about the QMS paradigm shift that we're introducing into the market when it comes to quality management and compliance. And it's centered around, as you can see here from left to right, number one is, and as I mentioned already, leveraging the benefits of a ready-to-use solution that really has everything you can possibly need already set up based on industry best practices. So this allows companies to focus on the commercialization aspects of the business, not worrying about lengthy and costly system implementations and projects. And at DOT, I think we've even went further, took the length of offering sample SOPs, for example, to support all the business process requirements that we have. And that is all included in the subscription at no extra cost. On the seamless deployment part, you can go live quickly with pre-configured business processes that also include tools to migrate any data or documents that your company might already have. Again, whether it's in folders or paper Excel, or even in other more antiquated systems. I know there's still a lot of on-prem systems out there which have limitations, especially in the post-COVID era. And then the one-stop shop concept too is we do leverage a wide area of solutions on one single technological platform. We scale with you, allowing your organization to easily expand to cover many other aspects of your business without a hefty price tag and with minimum user adoption costs, as this is all on the same platform. You also benefit from a holistic and single source of truth system in this case that can also include all of your applicable stakeholders, such as customers, suppliers, and of course, collaboration and integration with a lot of these other partners that we work with who are on the Salesforce platform. And then last but not least, enjoy all of this with a fully validated package at no extra cost for a very competitive subscription price on a state-of-the-art, as mentioned, technological platform. So with that said, I'll wrap up my part, pass it back to you, Denny, and of course, we'll be happy to address any questions later on. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much, Mickey. That was great. So next, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Brian Andrews with MedPro Systems. MedPro is one of the most recognized names in the industry. I think most of you have heard of them. They have over 600 life sciences clients. They're best known for providing excellent quality HCP and state license data in the US, but also have grown to provide much more, particularly in the transparency reporting category. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to you, Brian.
Great. Thanks, Denny. Good afternoon, everyone. I appreciate Denny and the Customertimes team for having me here today. My name is Brian Andrews. I'm the Senior Director of Business Development and Partnerships here at MedPro. And as background, MedPro is a trusted partner for the life sciences industry. We support pharma and med device companies in their pre- and post-launch business requirements for healthcare practitioner licenses and compliance advisory services. As Denny mentioned, our solutions are used by over 600 pharmaceutical and med device manufacturers, including 22 of the top 25 pharma in the world, but also hundreds of small to mid-sized companies like many of you on the webinar today. Next, please. So here at MedPro, our business philosophy is to provide the most up-to-date and comprehensive healthcare practitioner and healthcare organization profiles, every single HCP and HCO across the country, and make this information available in the vendor software and solutions that our customers use each day. In our core solutions for HCP data capture, we have several considerations. First, our 26 million record HCP and HCO national database that your office-based resources can do ad hoc lookups through our Web ID application. Or we can match and append your target list to our bulk ID batch solution, whether it's hundreds or tens of thousands of HCP records with the latest name, addresses, and identifiers, such as state, DEA, NPI, and AMA information. Our Direct ID vendor integration program has real-time HCP and HCO lookups in all leading MDM and CRM providers, such as those built on Salesforce.com like Customertimes, along with proactive sampleability updates that your field reps will have the latest statuses, expiration dates, and sanction checks for compliant interactions. Next. In our expanded solutions, we can help phone verify HCP data attributes such as office hours or providers' primary and secondary specialties to address off-label promotional concerns through our call center, provide a team for outsourced data stewardship services, sanction checks at the local, state, and federal level, and provide the latest affiliation relationships for any account-based selling. Next. As James mentioned earlier, for most pre-commercial manufacturers, our integrations and partnerships start with companies looking to prepare for and comply with open payments or Sunshine Act data capture and aggregate spend reporting. Our MedPro Compliance Reporting ID aggregate spend solution will ensure accurate and complete federal open payments, state and international transparency reports. Our MedPro Compliance Advisory Services team is staffed with attorneys and compliance and legal experts, folks that are experienced in the life sciences industry who can help create or enhance compliance programs. And finally, our MedPro Concur Connect solution provides real-time HCP lookups for your reps Concur expense reports to eliminate manual entry of HCP information out in the field. This industry-leading solution is used by over 450 companies today, and MedPro has been consistently named Concur's App Center Partner of the Year. So again, I really appreciate the time today. I look forward to connecting with each of you after the webinar, and I'll turn it over to Sergey and Denny.
Thanks so much, Brian. So next, I'll be presenting on the trend of true 360 customer view and engagement on Salesforce. Joining me for the Q&A is going to be Sergey Zenin, also with Customertimes, leading our vertical strategy team. There are several hot topics we're seeing in the market and hearing from our clients. 360 customer view, certainly, we're hearing a lot about marketing automation, omnichannel communication, how to derive greater insights, analytics, particularly in the predictive modeling arena, a lot about patient engagement, of course, with COVID, more and more about remote HCP engagement. And then in the medtech sector, the whole lead to cash order management process. So where are folks investing? You know, data integration between sales, marketing, customer services, cross-functional data literacy, strategic insourcing. Patient services is a good example where clients that have traditionally outsourced patient services want to get better control over their infrastructure and their data. And many are outsourcing the actual business process to third party like Indigene that we're going to introduce later. Predictive analytics, big topic and big area of investment. Folks are using this as an opportunity to refresh their campaign tools and omnichannel communication. And then for MedTech or order management, an entry is very important, integration with ERP into the lead to cash management process. So our focus is going to be around 360 engagement for this conversation. We actually believe that effective engagement, maximizing your interactions with your HCPs and your patients really begins at the 360 view perspective. The problem statement is the departments are engaging with your customers directly, but these communications are not accessible to other departments and functions. The dotted outside ring is broken. Each department is on an island with intra-departmental communications regarding your customer. For example, sales rep is planning their calls for the week. The rep would like to know if your customer engaged with Med Affairs for a medic info request with an MSL. Customer recently was recruited for a clinical trial. Customer responded to a marketing campaign inviting them to a seminar. Customer reported missing product in a recent order. These challenges can all be resolved with Salesforce as the platform engagement. Our focus at Customertimes is in the commercial area. However, we have a partner in the audience today, CloudBiz, who have Salesforce-based solutions for Med Affairs, drug safety, drug and device safety, and clinical trial management systems. Being on Salesforce, relevant interactions with your customer can be included in the commercial activities. At the core of effective engagement is the concept of an omnichannel communications hub, whereby each business department is enabled with a variety of channels by which they can engage with your customer. For example, telephony, portals, SMS, social media listening, social media advertising, and email. Your customer may also prefer one channel over others. For example, many HCPs now prefer SMS to email, as email is becoming the next voicemail. Breaking down each business area into functional categories of enablement, Salesforce, along with partners like Customertimes, Dot Compliance, CloudBiz, provide purpose-built applications to support each category of enablement, all fully integrated across the Salesforce platform. Examples include Health Cloud and Communities portals for customer and patient services, B2B and B2C commerce products like Commerce Cloud, Cloud Craze for orders, marketing automation with Marketing Cloud, social media listening and advertising, Pardot, Datarama for ROI on your analytics and your investment in your marketing programs. And for sales, our own CT Mobile suite, which extends standard Salesforce to support the unique requirements of field sales and inside sales reps. Let's just say that we prefer the color blue to the color orange. CT Mobile extends Salesforce with functionality unique to life sciences sales teams. CT Mobile, for example, at the upper left, is the core mobility product, which can mobilize online, offline, the sales engagement CRM on iOS, Android, Windows 10, or Edge devices. CT Presenter is for e-detailing CLM, capturing data and statistics of the presentation within the sales call and reporting these statistics to marketing. CT Orders is our order management module for MedTech and consumer health. It includes product catalog, order creation with pricing rules and your loyalty programs, sample and inventory management, and for larger clients, integration with SAP. CT Pharma and CT MedTech are our extended data models for Salesforce, including life sciences specific objects and business rules. The remote sales console enables field and inside sales reps to engage in remote calls, including presentations, training events, and remote signature capture for samples, med info requests, forms, and orders. CT Sign is our own signature capture model for clients who may not have Adobe or DocuSign, and it's included in our base package. So that's a really quick tour through how we can enable 360 view, what the business challenges are, how we can tie all these pieces together on Salesforce and empower all departments to engage with your customers more effectively. So that brings us to the end of the presentation component. Here in a minute, we're gonna turn it over to Q&A. But in addition to our core speaker panel, we also have additional partners we work with to support launch. Indigene, for example, is our partner for outsourced patient services. With our partnership, Customertimes implements the patient services omnichannel engagement hub on Salesforce for the client, and Indigene staff use the customer's platform to provide the service with Indigene resources. The client owns the technology and data, and Indigene provides the service. CloudBiz provide a comprehensive suite of Salesforce-based clinical trials management solutions, drug device safety, regulatory reporting, and soon releasing a Med Affairs module, which we're really, really excited about because that overlaps into the commercial area for us. Concert AI is focused on data quality, particularly around patient data PHI and HIPAA compliance, and provide insights and analytics, include competitive data and specialty pharma data aggregation and hub. Slipstream provide IT managed services and comprehensive service desk, which is a critical function to ensure your business users of all these new commercial systems you're going to be employing will be promptly taken care of from frontline tier one through more technical tier three support. And our newest partner is COAS, who provide business strategy and advisory. So where you saw James and Afore going through all of the enablement, COAS has the C-level business advisory on how they're going to launch the product, and they also have very deep expertise in pricing and contracting. COAS also is an agency to support brands for creative messaging and website development. So now we're into the QA section. We've concluded our presentation. I'm displaying the agenda, which has all the various speakers, the relevant topics, and open it up to questions from the audience.
Thank you, Danny. We have a first question from the audience. They're asking, what is the difference between HCP and patient portal?
The HCP and patient portal, I'll start. Actually, let me kick that over to Sergey.
Certainly. And Danny, can you hear me okay?
We can.
Excellent. Yeah, so patient portal is certainly a more prevalent theme in the industry, and patient portal, HCP portal is more prevalent. Patient portal is an emerging theme whereby in the process of either clinical trials or continuous engagement, there needs to be a secure hub of communication that simply cannot be delivered via email. And so it's a way to also alleviate some customer support issues and kind of create a self-service destination for patients, again, to either consume or process or react to content that's necessary, either, again, in the process of clinical studies or a lot of times what pharmaceutical companies are finding, the caregivers and or family members need to be interacting with different types of regimens and care plans. And so it's the simplest way to think about it are two different personas that are consuming that content, and they need to be communicated in a slightly different way. And as of late, the content that goes in there is accompanied by some triggers and some analytics on how it's being consumed. And so, as you can imagine, in the case of patients, they can also dovetail into the compliance and adherence programs as you're trying to engage them in a more comprehensive way. So that's, in a nutshell, the difference between HCP and patient portals.
Thank you. We have a lot more questions to cover, so I'm just going to quickly move to this next one. Okay. So the second question is, what are some of the factors that influence which functions to automate or enable with technology versus managing manually? That is, how do I mitigate or compress my spend on technology?
James, would you like to take that one?
Yeah, sure. There's a lot of layers to that one. For me, I would say the biggest area that probably requires technology over manual is anything related to compliance. And by technology, I also include data. So when it comes to compliant needs, whether it be for reporting to the governments, whether it be ensuring that you're getting signature capture, to ensuring that you're speaking to a licensed physician at a licensed organization, those are costs that the risk is just too great not to make the data or technology investments in. There are other factors where technology probably isn't as needed. For example, when the world was challenged to go virtual immediately, there are some options out there in the marketplace that were very expensive, and companies just made simply the choice that they're willing to take on a little more risk or handle the risk by ensuring they have training records that their people in the field will follow certain practices instead of making major investments in technology. As companies launch today at Afore, we recommend that they don't need to make an investment in an uber super compliant way to present content to physicians. You know, they can use Teams or they can use GoToMeeting or whatever those technologies, and ensure that your reps are trained and they're following processes and procedures rather than buying, you know, a very difficult system to use. You don't want to have technology get in the way of your business. It's kind of a phrase I use a lot. Don't do technology for technology's sake. But considering we just covered like seven different areas, it's kind of difficult to implement. But when you have a budget and you need to hit it, we can have those conversations with you. Because no matter which area we're referring to, there are options. There's pros and cons beyond just money, and we can help people with that.
Okay, so next question. So we have a data-related question here. How is data collected from hospital or physician electronic medical records?
Let me, Mahalis. Is that something you'd like to take? Yep. Is Mahalis's mic on?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, he's online.
So the question was related to electronic medical records. Can you restate the question, please?
Yeah, sure. How is data collected from hospital or physician electronic medical records?
So generally, that data is presented in the form of claims data that is purchased through third parties like IQVIA or Viva or Symphony, right? So whether you're talking about medical claims or patient claims, that information could come from specialty pharmacies as well, depending on the nature of the product we're discussing. So that's the means or the channels by which the data would be secured. And then eventually it would find its way into your centralized commercial data warehouse. Naturally, the data would need to be scrubbed or de-identified of any patient identifiable information, which in its own right requires a very bespoke process to be put in place in order to ensure compliance for the handling of that information based on where it's coming to you from and the degree of identifiable information contained in those record sets.
Also, I think if Ryan Davies is on the phone from Concert, I think they specialize in patient data as well. If you can activate Ryan's mic, if he's still on.
Yeah, Ryan.
Thanks, Danny. Yeah, I am. Thanks, Danny, and great job, everybody. So kind of adding to what Mihalis just covered there. So essentially what Concert Patient Solutions team does is we aggregate those different data sources, those SP hub data sources together, and then our ultimate output is what would go into that commercial data warehouse. So we use typically, we have an internal process to de-identify data, or we use an industry standard process as well. In either case, ultimately, you're getting access to that patient level data, and it's tokenized and produced for the manufacturer. Brett, anything else, Brett Piano, that you'd want to add to that?
Brett's might not be on. I mean, I think that sounds
pretty good. Yeah, he's on, but
like,
yeah,
we've got a lot of, sounds like we got a lot of questions, Siva. Want to keep moving?
Thanks, Danny.
Sure thing, Ryan.
Yeah, let's keep moving. The next question is, do the software platforms have ways to track accounts payable, receivable, payroll, and general ledgers?
I know Salesforce has partners that have that. Who would I, Sergey or James, want to take that one?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, James, if you want to chime in. Certainly, that's kind of a back office functions, a lot of times handled by the likes of PeopleSoft or SAP. I think the scope of today's discussion is certainly not in that realm, and that's something that we'd love to discuss with you. We'd love to discuss with you offline, as we have pretty deep SAP expertise as well, and a lot of our customers involve us specifically for the bridge between CRM and SAP, should that be your back office. That's the only kind of scope that I'm able to discuss.
Thank you, Sergey. So I'm moving to the next question. There's a lot to do here. When do you recommend to start this process?
Yeah, I think James covered that earlier, unless he's got something to add. Usually about 18 months before launch. I know my own experience in working with many of these partners in the past has been, if you're inside of 12 months to launch and just getting started, it's going to be pretty heads down race to meet that launch date. 18 months should be a comfortable timeline to get started with your planning.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is related to AI. How AI can influence the healthcare landscape in future?
Ooh, that's multidimensional. I'll turn that to Sergey.
Certainly, and I welcome any of our partners to chime in. I think I just had recently a conversation about this with a nonprofit who's looking to invest millions of dollars into different healthcare startups and organizations. And essentially, if they were to focus on AI, they wanted to know which hot topics and hot areas would be sort of on the horizon first versus, you know, it would take 5 to 10 years to get there. And to me personally, being a clinician by trade and spending a few number of years in the US healthcare system, I think nothing can benefit more from AI today than the diagnostics. It's pretty ripe for picking And I think if there was ever a fruitful partnership between our payer, provider, and life sciences organizations, I'd love to see them partner together on an open, sort of, if you envision open blockchain system type of setup, to partner together on detection of early stage diseases as well as rare diseases. I think those go undiagnosed for the longest periods of time and cost collectively our system a lot of money. So my personal favorite would certainly be diagnostics. But then again, in your day-to-day, kind of short of sci-fi, that's easy to envision any kind of early warning systems, especially with medical device and IoT type capabilities. But also, you know, patients and HCPs are exhausting an increasing amount of data and sending you a lot of signals that you probably are not gathering through your sales channels, your support channels, marketing channels, and just overlaying an AI on top of that can help us get in front of the right customer at the right time much quicker. So it sort of borders on diagnostics, but it's really delivering kind of a more dynamic message to the right person sooner. And that way we can get in front of some late stage diagnosis. We can get in front of caregivers that may be struggling with the right therapy, and we can help sort of obviously augment our collective sales pipeline and help organization both increase revenue and reduce cost and reduce risks. So that would be my spiel. I don't know if anyone else would like to chime in.
Yeah, maybe Ryan at Concert AI, and it might be interesting, if you've got 30 seconds more on the topic, for Dinesh. I know there's a lot of AI going on in clinical trials, and maybe Dinesh could chime in too. Ryan, is there anything you'd like to add?
Concert AI. Yep, there I am. Hi, guys. One of the things that the Concert AI is focused on is patient adherence is one of the biggest things from an AI perspective. So what we're doing is obviously aggregating and gathering historically common types of data like claims, claims SP hub, things like that. But what we're trying to do is add in additional data sources like social determinants of health, electronic medical records, formulary, behavioral health, financial, and so forth, and ultimately try to predict what patients will be running into as far as roadblocks. And ultimately, the idea there is to be able to predict what those patients in similar situations might need to be able to see, or you essentially, sorry, the manufacturer would be able to see this much earlier on in the process and be able to predict when those patients might actually need to be intervened with. So we look at it from a patient adherence perspective here at Concert. And Brett, I think you have something to add as well.
Did Brett have anything? Don't hear you, Brett.
Thank you, Danny. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Ryan hit it head on here. The key piece is really getting up front with the patient specificity and understanding and leveraging the connectivity of all the different data sources that are out there to inform approach patient engagement. So the partners like Indigene and others that would be interacting with patients can be a little bit more informed, and the approach to commercial interactions with the patients would be determined through the artificial intelligence machine learning techniques that we're implementing.
Great. I mean, this is one of the hot topics we're hearing. Dinesh, is there anything you'd like to add from the CTMS clinical domain perspective?
Certainly, Danny. So from the clinical research standpoint, as you know, the AI being, you know, looked at as a very, innovative technology and approach. There are many, you know, use cases in the clinical research space, you know, both operationally as well as a new product, you know, or all the use cases, you know, spread across, right? So from some couple of use cases in the AI standpoint in clinical research is obviously the risk-based monitoring throughout the clinical research, right? You know, basically to make sure that, you know, the data integrity, the data being collected is being, you know, evaluated against the protocol and any variations. And also in terms of the data which is being collected through the clinical research and come up with a better way of, you know, presenting that through the AI models. And of course, from the pharmacovigilance standpoint, you know, drug safety standpoint, you know, signal detection is another use case, you know, it's very relevant in this space. And ultimately, especially, you know, and earlier there was a mention about, you know, radioscope scanning results as well as the comparing, you know, the biomarkers, right? You know, detecting the biomarkers and then comparing with therapies. And that's a huge opportunity where industry is exploring. These are all the variations or options available where AI can help to bring in the innovation to the market.
All right, Seva, any more?
Yeah, we do have a few more questions. So I'm just gonna go through the list here because we still have 8 minutes left. So we might as well just finish the questions. Yeah, the next question is, what is the best practice for ensuring all the moving parts of my launch program remain coordinated?
I'm going to kick that one to Mahalis. If Mahalis is still on.
Yeah, he's on.
There we are.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Siva and Denny. Happy to take that question. Establishing a program management office, or what's known as a PMO function or a planning function, to manage and operate your launch program as a discrete function and as a discrete aspect of your launch is critical, right? Not only is it important to establish the capability, but it needs to be serviced by a representative who has a very unique skill set for understanding all of the moving parts, functionally speaking, right? So what are the functions and aspects of market access, and what is their relevance and importance in a launch? Same for Med Affairs, same for sales, same for marketing, the list goes on and on. Beyond that, need to understand all of the underlying technologies that automate and enable the functions related to each of those domains or disciplines. And then thirdly, need to have a skill set methodology for establishing and maintaining the governance to keep all the moving parts operating in a very well-orchestrated, coordinated fashion, right? So establishing a PMO is the short answer. Establishing a PMO with the right skill set is an important nuance, and making sure that the right KPIs and metrics for launch readiness are instituted early so that you don't deviate off course early on and spend your entire launch program trying to play catch up. So best practice would be to recognize the need for a program management office, institute it early in your process, and ensure that you have the right skill set of individuals participating in that PMO to help drive the governance.
Thanks, Mahalis.
Thank you. Okay, our next question is for Afore. I'm familiar with Viva Network for MDM, but if you went with Salesforce for CRM, what do you recommend to your clients for MDM and commercial analytics?
I don't necessarily want to make a suggestion. There are a bunch on the industry that work without plugging Salesforce too much. I think every good MDM out there works very seamlessly with Salesforce. Whether it be MedPro for lookup, whether it be Viva Network solution or Reltio, they all have really pretty seamless integration. And in today's age, with an MPI identifier for HCPs, et cetera, it's pretty easy to do if it's done well. So there's no real solution it would involve more conversations with clients to understand what their actual fundamental need is. Are they an HCO focused organization that's going to be primarily contacting hospitals? Are they going to be working with group practices or physicians directly? There's more nuance than simply the technology, but the good news is with Salesforce, there are a lot of good options out there.
Thank you, James. I think this is our final question and then we'll wrap it up. This is for Customertimes. We are looking at marketing automation. Can you tell me the difference between Marketing Cloud and Pardot?
That's definitely a Sergey question.
Yeah, Siva and Danny, I'll take that one. So it's kind of an increasingly more interesting question as both product sets have been gaining momentum in the space. Traditionally, 7 years ago, when I was at the Marketing Cloud organization, we would say one is more has more strength in the B2B space. The Pardot grew up in the age of marketing qualified leads, SQLs, MQLs, and if you're doing that scoring and distributing leads to the sales organization, there's really interesting automation options there and triggers and all that is great. Should you decide to venture in direct-to-patient sphere and, again, communicate even potentially with caregivers and proxy members of the team, you quickly start running into a very complex kind of decision trees in the automation, and you may also desire to go multi-channel with those. As soon as you start running into that kind of requirements, Marketing Cloud becomes a no-brainer because it then layers on top of that, not just the automation and some form of scoring, but also different delivery methods of your messaging. And it's, in a sense, at the heart of Marketing Cloud is also a listening engine. We spent a lot of time today talking about data and analytics and AI that's been deeply integrated in the process. And so it makes a decision, a communication decision based on all kinds of input. And its segmentation engine is bar none, the most robust in the market. And I'm speaking from a perspective of digital marketing, career digital marketer. So it, in the end, it depends on the user within your organization. Is it a more a digital marketer type, kind of an agency skill set that you're running, or it's a typical kind of campaigns deployment and lead scoring and lead distribution type of function? If you're finding yourself somewhere in between, I would highly encourage you to receive a free demo either from Customertimes or from directly from Salesforce on both, and just organize kind of the user base into a small panel, and we're certainly happy to help you make the final decision on that.
All right, well, Sivit, that's our last question. I think we're coming to the top of the hour. I really appreciate everyone taking time. It looks like that most of the folks that started the meeting stayed around. And as I mentioned at the beginning, we are recording this and we'll get the recording of the webinar out to all the participants. Thanks again, and everyone have a fantastic rest of your day.